And now, bismillah, we have our last topic before we break for Salah. And then after that, we'll have our Q&A session with Sheikh Wael Ibrahim. Right now, we have our session with Sheikh Yahya Adil Ibrahim. Sheikh Yahya Adil Ibrahim is based out of Perth, Australia. He's a lecturer in Al Maghrib Institute, and he's also the principal of Langford Islamic College in Australia. And inshallah, his topic will be about how to redeem ourselves from committing all these sins, and how to stay away, and how to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all haram, inshallah. Tafaddal, Sheikh Yahya Ibrahim.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim tasliman kathira. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa zid wa barik ala sayyidina wa habibina wa nabiyina Muhammadin fil awwalin wa salli wa sallim wa zid wa barik ala sayyidina wa nabiyina Muhammadin fil akhirin. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa zid wa barik ala sayyidina Muhammad fil mala'il a'la ya arhamar rahimin. It is a great pleasure, alhamdulillah, to join in virtually all the way from across the world, alhamdulillah, from Perth, Western Australia, with my dear brothers and sisters in Toronto, Canada. MashaAllah, the world-renowned Abu Huraira Islamic Center. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to favor its board and trustees and administrators and imams. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lead them to that which is pleasing to Him and turn them away from that which is disuniting and taking of their strength and sapping of the iman of themselves and the community. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to use them for that which is khair and protect them from all sharr and all open and hidden and unseen danger. Allahumma ameen. It is a wonderful initiative, alhamdulillah, that I've been contacted to support with raising awareness about pornography, its danger, and how, inshallah, as a community, as families, and also as individuals, that we are able to wage a battle against this sinful, destructive, mind-altering, intoxicating behavior that has swept through different parts of the world. Growing up in Toronto, subhanAllah, there was pornography then. I'm not that old, subhanAllah. But to get it, to be able to access it, meant that you'd have to go to a video store, get one of those big old VHSs and sit with it in your lounge room, in your front reception, and put it in and watch it on a TV. But today, subhanAllah, the world has changed. It is estimated that people as young as 10 years old, as being the majority age when they are first exposed to pornographic images and videos and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our families, our homes, and our communities. Allahumma ameen. And I know you're going to hear a lot of this from my dear brother, my colleague, our brother Wa'il, hafidhahullah, who's an expert in this discussion. He's written books, articles, and has led presentations on it. There is much benefit that can be taken from his discourse and discussion in this regard, inshallah. But you will hear much from all of the different panels and the different people who have been assembled. My contribution today is to speak about resistance, resilience, and self-love, and to speak about a psychology of redemption, a psychology of change. And I wanted, inshallah, to speak about it, of course, from our sources as Muslims. As Muslims, we have no problem with the natural sciences and the sciences that relate to human understanding and the conceptualization of how we work and how we think as human beings, the socializations that we establish and how we react in different cognitive ways to the stresses that are around us. So I come to you from my office here at my school. I'm an assistant principal. And subhanAllah, one of the modules I teach Islamic studies, of course, it is my passion and I will always be in the classroom, alhamdulillah, irrespective of any administrative positions. But one of the main sections that I will have with the gentlemen, with the boys, is to speak to them about pornography. And this actually is part of my online Islamic school. It's something you can access, yahyaibrahim.com/puberty. And the Islamic school, it's courses that deal with how young people can be led to pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and understanding the responsibility. And one of the key factors for parents is at times we don't teach our children how to repent to Allah. We teach them how to cook and to clean and how to do the dishes and the chores and their homework and be successful in school. But one of the things at times that we fail at is how to fix a mistake, how to stop doing something that you know is wrong, you don't want to do, you know it's something that upsets you, is something displeasing to Allah, that you're afraid to be caught doing it. You know it's something that's haram in our deen. Well, how do I stop? What do I need as a frame of reference in my mind? How do I prepare myself to repent? So I want to speak to parents and I want to speak to young people equally together. As parents, these should be things that you're able to teach in your children. These are things you should be able to raise in your children, this standard of how to become a better person and to regain balance after you've fallen off and done something you're displeased with. And one of the core things the Prophet ﷺ taught our ummah, taught the young sahaba, was how to recover from error, how to recover from a mistake, and the psychology of redemption and repentance. And I hope that this could be of great value, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. So I'm only going to limit my discussion to 3 points, okay? 3 points that I want you to pay attention to, and I want you to keep in your heart, and I want you to pay particular care to the discussions in it. And if you're able to take notes, please do so, so that you can return to it, and more importantly, be able to teach it on to others. The first important point for a person to, within themselves, to grow the capacity to want to make a change after wrong, to gain the ability to repent, to have redemption, to become a better person after a fault and after having wronged themselves, ظلموا أنفسهم, is the first, there has to be self-confrontation, self-examination. In Arabic, we speak to it, you know, in our Islamic psychological perspective, in our Islamic cosmological perspective, how we understand it, it is called al-muhasaba. Al-muhasaba is that you hold yourself accountable. Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, hasibu anfusakum qabla an tuhasabu. Take account of yourselves before Allah will take account of you. Meaning, count your deeds before Allah will count them. Wazinuha qabla an tuzanu. And weigh yourself, weigh your deeds out before Allah will weigh you. وَتَهَيَّأُ الْعَرْضِ الْأَكْبَرِ. Prepare yourself for the day of becoming publicly shamed. يَوْمَ لَا تُبْلَى الصَّرَائِرِ. When no sins will ever be hidden from others on the day of judgment and on the day that Allah exposes us. May Allah protect us in this dunya. Self-confrontation, self-examination, al-muhasaba, holding yourself to account, becomes the first step amongst other steps to be able to gain in your heart, in your mind, the ability and the strength to repent and to redeem yourself from something you know you shouldn't be doing. Self-confrontation, of course, is going to require honesty. Subhanallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, قُلْ أَعِذُكُمْ بِوَاحِدَ أَن تَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ مَثْنَى وَفُرَادَ. Allah speaks to the mushrikeen at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, who would hear things from different people. Allah would say, listen, I'm going to advise you to just sit with yourself or maybe one other person. Don't, it's not a public thing, just you within yourself. ثُمَّ تَتَفَكَّرُوا. Then think about the issue, about Muhammad ﷺ. In this case, think about who you are, what you want, what's halal, what's haram, what's benefit, what isn't, shameful from unshameful. What are the things that are significant for you to deliberate on and to move forward in life with? And think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the one who is observing of all things, who will confront and will ask. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادِ, the hearing, the sight, and the movements of their heart, كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ, all of that and more, كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا, all of that they will be questioned about on the day of judgment. Self-confrontation is that you examine yourself and take stock. Say to yourself, what benefits do I gain from viewing this? What sexual release maybe do I feel? What lowering of tension? The you know, subhanAllah, the masturbation that is usually attached to it. What do I gain from it in those moments, in those seconds that pass? And what do I have to lose? What are the things that are significant? What are the risks that I take? And what are the things that need to be considered? And you will overwhelmingly find, as you will hear in many of the other discussions, that there is so much more to lose, so much more to affect your future, so much more in your relationship with Allah, so much more to be lost than there is in those moments to be gained. Self-confrontation becomes an important aspect. And therefore, I turn to our parents and I say, if you are making your child more fearful of you than the consequence between them and Allah, you are not doing them a service. If you are making it about policing them rather than teaching them to police themselves, you are not doing them any favors. If you have not set up learning patterns for yourself to learn how to manage your children, how to work cooperatively with them, you are setting yourself up for failure. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, for our young children, لَعِبُوهُمْ لِسَبْعَ, for the first 7 years of your child's life, play with them. That's it. Teach them ibadah and everything through play. It's just playing with them, 7 years old. ثُمَّ صَاحِبُوهُمْ لِسَبْعَ, then be their friend for the next seven. Up until they're 14, it's about friendship and endure, you know, right? Giving them the command. This is a tradition of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then after the seven, once they're 14, muruhum, you know, be a command in their life, be a companion in their life, and be their friend throughout until they advance into their adulthood and that they are fulfilling their obligations to Allah. Discipline does not mean that you are there to enforce when they have stepped away. Discipline is to teach them the boundaries that they monitor without you being present, that they have learned through the pattern that you have instilled in their life, through what they see in your actions, in your behavior, in your love, that this is what I want to do, rather than I'm watching my father once he turns from me. If my mother is not watching, I will do what I want. That's not discipline. That is the opposite of discipline. So self-confrontation becomes very important for anyone to be able to return to Allah, to return from any mistake, even if it's not a spiritual sin. They must first examine themselves, confront themselves, and be convinced themselves that this is not what they want. The second step is then, if they are convinced that this is something that I don't want to do, it's now about, and that's the aim of this conference that we're speaking in. The second step is self-regulation, is self-control, self-behavior management, moderating my own actions, my own thoughts, my own behaviors, taking charge of who I am, why I am, doing the things that I do, taking account of everything that I seek to have done. And that's another one of the points that I stress in particular in my online Islamic school. In particular in that puberty section, it's for, you know, 8-9 years old up until 13-14 years old. There's a program then that's run after it for those who are 14 to 18-19 years old called Sexual Ethics in Islam. How do we view sex? How do we view relationships? How do we view halal and haram? How do we contend about issues that relate to same-sex attraction and sexuality and all of these kind of things? It's an important discussion that needs to be had. All of that, you know, you can find it at yahyaibrahim.com. But what's important is that we teach how to self-regulate. You need to learn the tools. How do I self-regulate? How do I regulate myself? How do I found a sirat al-mustaqim? How do I find that balanced way of life? The middle road, where you are not excessive and where I'm not deficient, where I'm not extreme and where I'm not negligent, where I'm not using too much or not giving enough. All of that becomes very important in learning self-control. And there are processes that don't relate to Islam that can teach you self-control. In fact, our deen, part of all of the acts of worship that you and I do, one of the key things that it's seeking to teach you is self-control and behavior modification. So think, for example, siyam. It's because Allah ordered us. But what is it teaching you? It's teaching you that I can control myself, that cup of coffee, subhanAllah, this beautiful cup of coffee, which, you know, mashallah, I'm craving at the moment. This cup of coffee, bismillah. in any other day in the month of Ramadan, I won't touch it. Why? It doesn't matter. I'm alone in my room. Nobody can see me. No one knows. Why? Because I regulate myself. I control myself. Why? Because I know Allah is there. That's a major thing, Ramadan. Taking that as a lesson, then you begin to self-regulate other aspects in your life. Your salah, whether I am conscious of Allah in my salah or not, how much dhikr am I making in my salah or not, what is the difference between the hypocrite in salah and the one who isn't hypocrite? وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Allah says that in their prayer they remember Allah seldom. So I begin to self-regulate. No, I want to make their mention of Allah. I want to make my ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to hold myself accountable to Allah in a meaningful way. Hajj, all of it is about self-control. Subhanallah, don't get angry. فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقْ وَلَا جِدَالٍ. Don't argue, no sexual sexual behavior. Control yourself in Hajj. What about zakah? Subhanallah. Nobody wants to give. وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ They put others before them even though they might need. You give sadaqah, you give zakah. Why? Because it's self-control. You learn, no, I can go without because the needs of others are important. The tawheed of Allah, the salah, iqam as-salah, it's all about sabr. SubhanAllah, Fajr now in Perth is 4 a.m. in the morning. I would love to sleep until 7, but I'm up at 4. The family's up at, why? Why are you up at that time? The whole street is blacked out. Everybody's asleep except us. Why? Because of self-control, self-regulation. Knowing that I am accountable to Allah, so I confronted myself. I'm going to be accountable to Allah. I need to do something about it. What am I going to do? Naturally follows to begin to control and to moderate my behavior, manage how I approach what I see in life and what I encounter in life. And that becomes an important thing for parents to teach self-control. To teach, you know, self-control and regulation becomes important. You say to your children, for example, clean your room. They go to school and then you clean it for them. There's no self-control that they've taught there. There's no self-regulation. There's no behavior management that they've just learned. You've just taught them to do the opposite of what you're asking. So it becomes very important for us as parents to learn how to teach self-control. And I hope, inshallah, that we can do more engagement with our dear brothers at Abu Huraira and teach some of those important techniques. There's a program that I teach about bad parenting. And forgive me for using that word. SubhanAllah, there's a lot of bad parents. There's a lot of parents who ruined good children. They had wonderful children, and had it been that they learned how to be a better parent, had they learned the sunnah, had they learned from the way of the Prophet ﷺ, their children would not be in the difficult places they're in today. And this is a reality. May Allah protect us, Ya Rabbi. Lastly, self-sacrifice. SubhanAllah. So confront yourself. Okay, now I'm going to begin to control myself. Now, for me to achieve the first two, I need to give for myself. I need to sacrifice for myself. And that's where sadaqah comes in, helping others without expecting a return. Wallahi, it's very rare today that you can walk in the street and somebody sees you needing help and they stop to help you. You see those incidents all the time in subways and trains and planes where people are just, you know, in their phone, me, myself, and I. They've forgotten everybody else around them. Nobody wants to get involved. No one will help somebody in trouble. Why? Because they've lost the concept, the importance of self-sacrifice. Self-sacrifice is what allows you to redeem yourself. How do you make up for a mistake? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you simply in the Quran. إِنَّ الْحَسَنَةِ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ Good deeds cancel out sinful behavior, cancel out the mistakes. When you do good to others, Allah will send others to do good to you. When you help others, Allah will help you. When you cover the mistakes of others, Allah covers your mistakes. When you are charitable with others, Allah yunfiq alayna wa alaykum. Allah spends, you know, grants us His generosity upon myself and you. The Prophet ﷺ said, مَا نَقْصَ مَالٍ مِنْ صَدَقَةٍ Never is charity depleted from wealth. Never is your time taken from you if you spent it towards the assistance of others. Never is your health wasted when you put it in lieu of the needs of others. So self-sacrifice, teaching our children, you becoming as a young man, as a young woman, learning the importance of giving from myself. لَن تَنَالُ الْبِرُّ You will never achieve righteousness. حَتَّى تُنْفِقُ مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ Until you give from the things you love the most, until you sacrifice. Why do you think Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is such a powerful example in my life and your life? Because he is the greatest person who showed sacrifice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar. Give your slaughter, give your sacrifice to Allah. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was one who was willing to give, to give, to give, to give, until the people said, this man gives as if he fears no poverty. This is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So give from your time, give from your wealth, give from your sadaqah to protect your home and your children. Make fida. Why do we make qurban when we have a boy or a girl? Why do we have two sheep for the boy? Because boys are going to give you so much trouble. You're asking Allah, oh Allah, I give this in charity. I give this to feed people, to bring joy to others. Oh Allah, bring me joy with my son. He's going to be difficult later on in life. The daughter is mercy. It's only one sheep. The boy, subhanAllah, double the effort. Right? Our boys are double the effort. May Allah give us help with our young men. I have a series of talks. It's called The Art of Manliness. Right? The Art of Manliness. It's about puberty and young men in particular. Not because it's mine, but I do recommend it for you. It is based on the curriculum that I teach here in Perth to my students. The Art of Manliness, how to grow up as a fata, fityatun amanu bi rabbihim. Young men who grew up in the relationship with Allah. You could see the link there. It's yahyaibrahim.com /puberty. Check it out. I ask you, inshallah, to take care of our young men. Take care of the young brothers. Take care of their heart. Take care of their body. And take care of their soul. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use you and I for good. Allahumma ameen. If you put these three things together, self-confrontation, self-regulation, and self-sacrifice, what you build is in your mind the ability and the psychology of presence of mind to say, yes, I can make a change. I want to change. I can do something about it. I'm convinced this isn't what I want to do. I've confronted myself. I know that I can control myself. I know I have the skills and the desire and the will to do it. Number three, I'm going to commit myself, not just for myself, but for the betterment of everybody around me. This is why we teach the Quran. This is why we teach the Sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ, he says, حَدِّثُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Why does he tell you to teach even if it's just one verse? Because the one who helps others, Allah helps them. The one who opens a door for others, Allah opens 70 doors for them. The one who protects a believer, Allah protects them, right? So be involved in all three aspects. It gives you then the strength to say, I want to push away from pornography. I want to clean my eyes. I want to protect my heart. I want to remove the sins that have already happened. And I want Allah to replace them with good deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. Those who believe, إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ, those who repent, وَآمَن, repent, what is it? Examine themselves, know what they did was wrong, confront themselves, prepare never to do this again, develop self-control, and number three, commit, أَلَّا يَعُودَ إِلَّا, I'm never going to do this again, I'm going to help others against it, تَابَ, آمَنَا, believes in Allah, believes Allah can heal them, believe Allah will forgive them, believes Allah has asked for better than what they have given. وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا, and lives good life, self-sacrificing for others. فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. Allah will change their evil deeds to good deeds. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala change our mistakes in the past to positive, righteous deeds into the future. May Allah assist you and I and protect you and I and elevate all of us status. Allahumma ameen. وَصَلِّ اللَّهُمَّ وَسَلِّمْ وَزِدْ وَبَارِكْ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا وَنَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدْ صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.